He's a singer, and he's a man that can shake, rattle, and roll. And he takes us down memory lane week after week with Where Are They Now? And the song of the week. To finish the show, it's our pop encyclopedia, Shane.
It's the Big Hey. Welcome.
How are you, mate?
Young Shane Hales.
What a good show tonight. I'm really enjoying it.
Yes.
I've sat back and listened to everybody else and really, really thoroughly enjoyed it.
Oh, thank you, Shane. Yeah. You were in the green
room.
You're
not too bad yourself. Yes, I was in the green room.
And you had a nice glass of wine, I see.
You're very generous here. But no, it was great, yeah.
You get a quarter of a glass. That's
yeah, yeah. It's a nice big screen in the green room. I just sat back and watched it.
Oh, good on you, Shane. Yeah. Now, you had some great news last week. You went and saw a icon of New Zealand pop.
I certainly did. A great friend of ours, Ray Columbus.
And everyone wants
to know how Ray is.
Ray?
And Ray is okay. Yeah. He's okay. I mean, we were up there. It was Susie and Judy of the Chicks.
Yep.
They came up. Ray Wolf, myself, and a couple of your band, The Rumour. We were all up there to have a photo done, a photo shoot.
Yeah.
And Ray was dressed in his leather pants and his pinkish wine-coloured shirt. Every bit the rock star. Silver hair pushed back, and he was cool.
He looked great.
And he was in high spirits, to be honest, and it was good to see him. It was rather upsetting because to see him not so unwell, but Ray, you know, we love him, and he was really good. And he was exhausted when we left. I know we were there probably 4 hours, had a bit of lunch, and when we left, he was pooped. But great to see him and great to catch up. And I know he was thrilled to see all of us together as a club again, you know, all the old friends.
Gather in baby boomers and think back to Ray Columbus in the prime of his youth singing She's a Mud.
She's a Mud.
She's a Mud. Wasn't it? And, you know, his head was going like that.
And he's the old mod nod.
Did we ever think?
The mod father.
Did we ever think that...
Well, none of us do, but anyway, I won't dwell on that.
Cause don't get morbid, Jerry.
Yeah, exactly. Don't get morbid. Let's not go there. I just wanted to say he was in high spirits, and it was great to see him, and I was thrilled to see him, actually, and we had a wonderful time.
If Ray's watching tonight...
Yeah, good on you, Ray.
Get well.
Keep rocking.
Keep rocking.
Yeah. Now, who else is keeping on rocking? Well, I was rocking. I was out at Huapai Domain over the weekend with a band called Indigo Blue, who were absolutely fantastic. Did a great show out there with them. And, of course, then I was back with the Shads in Orewa at the Country Music Club, believe it or not. Don't know how I got there, but that turned out to be a great gig. Good people, wonderful people, and great hosts. Made us all welcome. And, so if you're not doing anything and you live up Hibiscus Coast, Orewa Country Music Club. Good place.
Shane, should we let it out of the bag? It's a well-kept
secret. Let it out the bag. We let you out the bag.
Our first mention is you are going to have your own show.
We're going to have our own TV show.
It's called Rocking the Planet.
Rocking the Planet. And we are definitely going to do that. Just
that. It's a half-hour show every week. And it's
nice and snappy.
Feature a brand-new band.
It doesn't have to be a brand-new. It can be an old band.
An old band.
An old band, a new band, any band that is good, and we'll check them out and let you see all the great bands that are around New Zealand that we don't get to see these days. And so much talent out there, it's not getting a fair go anywhere else on TV, let's be honest.
Yeah.
So we thought we'd do that and rock the planet, rock New Zealand, and get the show on the air.
So Shane, if there's a band watching now and they'd say we'd love to be on Rocking the
Please.
Planet, how do they get hold of you?
Get hold of us at The Beat Goes On. Email Gerard at The Beat Goes On. Best way to go. And he'll pass it on to me here at The Beat Goes On. And we'll get this underway. And it's going to be a live gig every week. And we'll be filming you. And it'll be fantastic.
Good,
we'll have
you,
a
Shane.
Lot of fun.
Yeah.
And Gerard is the producer, so I still have to behave myself.
Now, Shane, all that, of course, pales into insignificance.
It does.
Compared to
Song of the Week. And it's a beauty. Now, I've been really working on this one. Now, I thought we'd get some eye candy for all the girls out there.
Ooh.
Eye candy for the girls in the form of David Bruce Cassidy. Now, we all know that without the Bruce, David Cassidy. And he was the pop idol from Mars. I mean, this guy, they loved him. They drooled. They went crazy over him.
He was the Justin Bieber.
I don't think Justin Bieber gets the same adulation even now with millions more people on the planet than David Cassidy got. They just idolized him. You know, the man was a freak. A beautiful looking guy. And that's as far as we'll go for now. I'll tell you the rest later. But what happens? How did it all start? Now, he was born April the 12th, 1950. I thought he was a little bit older, but no, he's not. He's younger than me. Everyone is. April the 12th, 1950. So he's going to turn 64 in just a few weeks. And happy birthday, David. His father was Jack Cassidy, a very famous actor. And you'd know him. Yeah. You've seen him in lots of musicals. Yeah. He was an all-round actor, an amazing actor, but he had a lot of problems and not a great father figure for David because he was an alcoholic. He had bipolar, diagnosed with bipolar, and he was bisexual.
He got the three prizes.
He had three great prizes there.
What's that? He was an alcoholic, bipolar, and
bisexual. And any other bi you could think of, I guess he had it, but poor old Jack. But what an amazing actor. But it took its toll on his personality and everything. He had a lot of mental problems. Now, he married a beautiful actress called Evelyn Ward, beautiful girl, and made a lot of movies, well known in the Hollywood circles and things. So the two of them were great, and quite an item. The thing was, David, by the time he was 6 years old, 1956, he first found out that his parents were divorced. He didn't know they'd got divorced in 1954. He lived with his grandparents because they were always perpetually on the road working, doing movies and musicals and theater. So poor old David was farmed out to the grandparents. So he was playing with the neighbors' kids and they said, oh, your mum and dad are divorced. And he said, what? He doesn't know anything. What the hell they're talking about? He's 6 years old. And that's how we found out about their separation. But Jack, his father, married soon after. He'd had an affair for over a year with Shirley Jones. And so they were married.
Partridge Family?
Yeah, the Partridge Family. It all came to fruition, you see. He married Shirley Jones, the actress, and he carried on with his work. She did hers. What happened was by 1969, David had done a few movies and bits and pieces as a bit actor, trying to get famous, breaking into Hollywood. He's only 19 years old. The Partridge Family part comes up. Now, Mum turns out to be the star of the show. She's got the part. So she introduces her son, David, her stepson, and brings him in because he's got the beautiful good looks. The producers love him.
Yeah.
And
So the whole idea was Shirley Jones, it was going to be her show, wasn't it?
It was going to be her. She was the star of the show, the Partridge Family.
Yeah.
And within, two or three episodes, it was David Cassidy.
Yeah.
He had these androgynous good looks and there was a whole gay community loved him. There was a whole straight community loved him. And every teeny bopper on the planet loved him. I mean, he's a beautiful looking boy.
Yeah.
It moves on, he takes over. And suddenly, the Partridge Family, they turn out to have 12 1 million selling albums. Now, in between this 12 million records that they sell, he has several solo records. He has seven of them, actually. And they all sell over a million.
Mm.
And so this is in the time space by 1974, between 1969, 5 years, he sold millions and millions of records. So his concerts become huge, and they actually called it Cassidy Mania.
Mm.
And it really did turn on, just the same as the Beatles. It was crazy stuff. His concerts, there were riots in Madison Square Garden when he played there. They turned the place, they wrecked the place. He played Wembley Stadium. I was there in 1974, and he played six in a row, absolutely capacity crowds at Wembley Stadium. And then he went around the world and carried on. But what happened in 1974, again, late 1974, there was another huge concert there. Over 300 people were injured, three young, around the front of the stage. There was a huge crush to the front. Turned out that one girl got killed in the mass of. And this destroyed him. He couldn't believe it happened. So he thought about it and he started to think, I'm going to toned down the touring. Mm. It was quite a thing. He couldn't get over it, really. Mm. And he was worried and very concerned about the fans from then on. Now, I know, I was in New Zealand. I'd come back to New Zealand after that Wembley concert in 1974. And I happened to meet him. And we were, what happened was, friends of mine, the La-Di-Da's, great 60s band that we all know and love, were over here on the Saturday. They were supporting at Western Springs Stadium, they were supporting Elton John. So they were staying at the, you know, the place up in Parnell, the White Heron Hotel, the old Kerrigodian Hotel up there. And so was David Cassidy. He was playing the Town Hall on the Friday night. So we're all up there having drinks before the gig, and I'm up there with my mates, the La-Di-Da's. And Elton decides we're all going to go to the concert and see Davey play. So David's on stage when we arrive, and we all stand at the back of the hall. The screaming girls are going crazy. And Elton gets up, and he gets called up by David Cassidy to get up and jam with him. So Elton gets on the grand piano, starts jamming with Dave, and they do Rock Around the Clock and a few other songs. We're all having a great time, you know. Yeah, go Elton, go David. And then we all, after the concert, great successful concert, full house. And the next night, we've got Elton's concert down at Western Springs. But before this, we all go to Tommy Adderley's club, Grandpa's upstairs, and good old Tommy's club. We all went down, all the musos. Mm. And we all, a whole load of us went down there. And we're all sitting around the table, and then a guy gets up and has a go at Elton John and calls him a faggot, and all hell breaks loose. Mm-hmm. And there's a punch up, and Elton storms down the club. They had that big staircase. Mm-hmm. He put a fur coat over his shoulders, and he stormed down the stairs. Prima donna, walked out of there, said, "Ah, you, getting out of here." And then the entourage followed him. Mm-hmm. And I'm left there, David Cassidy, myself, and my girlfriend. We're sitting at a table going, well, that was pretty wild, you know. We're laughing, and David Cassidy, I left him there with my girlfriend. Mm. I went off to the bathroom, toilet. I came back, never leave David Cassidy with your girlfriend. By the time I got returned, I came up the stairs, I sat down again. I said, "Hey, David, want a drink, blah, blah." He said, my girl's going, "Goo, goo, gaga," with starry-eyed. Yeah. And she turns to me and says, "David just told me how beautiful I am, and he's asked me to go to Hawaii with him." And I said, "Oh, yeah." And I laughed and I said, "That's David." And she said, I said, "Yes." I was like, "What?" She said, "I've said yes. And in 2 days' time, he's going to Hawaii. His tour's finished and he's off to Hawaii for a few days. And he's asked me, he's going to pay my fare and take me with him." So we had a few words. And David's sitting there having a drink, a bourbon or something. Anyway, we had a few words, and I actually exited down the stairs with my girlfriend, and she did come with me. Mm. But I was just brokenhearted that she'd considered it. So I ended it with her after a few days. Yeah. She should have gone, because that was it. It blew me away, you know. Wow. So David Cassidy, yeah, that was my meeting. I never saw David again after that.
Yes.
But now the poor man, he's in the middle of a terrible situation. Mm. Totally.
Punishment.
It's all come back and bitten him on the proverbial backside. And he's having a terrible time. He's just been done for DIC, or what we call it over here, drunk in charge of a car, twice the legal limit. And he had to spend 96 hours compulsory in jail. He's come out, and he still might have to go to jail because it's the third time in 3 years. And his girlfriend, Sue Schifrin, has left him. His wife, of 27 years. She's walked out on him and said, "That's it, I can't stand it anymore." But the marriage has been over, she says, for several years. And Sue Schifrin, great songwriter, beautiful artist and singer on her own, he is devastated. And we don't know what's gonna happen to him. He may end up in jail for a year, is the max for him coming up. So Dave is going through a really bad time at the moment. Very sad to hear. I don't wish him any. I've got nothing, no animosity against the poor guy.
So I can surmise, Shane, that you never, ever, ever asked another man's girlfriend out like David Cassidy did yours.
I probably did, but I never got caught.
So I can survive, Shay, that tonight's song of the week has got to be
Rock Me Baby from 1972, from the album of the same name, David Cassidy.
You may call me a rolling stone, I'm a football man and a standalone. I come a looking for a little satisfaction. I don't drive no Cadillac, all I got's hanging on the back. But I do believe in a physical attraction. I can warm your coldest night, I'll make everything alright. Woman, ooh, rock me baby, let me feel that beat. I said, ooh, rock me baby, right down to my feet. I said, ooh, rock me baby, hold me oh so tight. I said, ooh, rock me baby, rock me through the night. You better hold me while you can, or you're gonna lose your midnight man. Now come on and rock me, rock me.
Oh, look at that suit, Shane.
What a beautiful suit. I wouldn't mind that now. I think there was a bit of Gary Glitter. I think it looks like one of Gary Glitter's old suits. But anyway,
well, it's good to see and be reminded of David Cassidy once again.
Yeah, wonderful. And he's still working. He's doing big concerts. He's over the last few years, in between the driving. He's been back to Wembley and played a big sellout concert there, not six nights in a row anymore, but he's still working at different things, acting. He's in a lot of theatre.
He's going to pull the big nostalgia crowd.
But he still get the nostalgia crowds, as we all do. You know, that's what happens. Yeah. As they say, the trick isn't simply to hold on to fame, it's to survive it.
Wow.
And this is the hard part he's going through right now. Will he survive it? A lot of his friends are saying that they think he might not survive this. Mm. His drinking, I mean, they found a bottle of bourbon in his car when he got arrested, and it's very, very sad, and I hope he does survive it. And he's turning 64 in just 3 or 4 weeks, and the man is a star. He's done it all, you know. And did you know? Did you know?
Take me by surprise, please.
Johnny Cymbal wrote that song, Rock Me Baby, our song of the week. Johnny Cymbal, who wrote, "Hey, Mr. Bassman, won't you teach me the way you sing? Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba." We all know that song.
That
I love
good,
it.
Yeah.
Well, Johnny Cymbal wrote that song, yeah. And he wrote Cinnamon Let Me In by Derek.
Good old Johnny Cymbal.
Johnny Cymbal, just thought you'd like to know that. Stop me now in my tracks.
Shane Hales. as well as being a sterling job.
Thank you.
Sterling.
Thank you.
I can only say you've done it again.
I was 12 when I left home. Ever since I've been on.